the Source Wall. Behind it is the single greatest secret of the universe. This is as far as I dare to go.
Hey, what's up, everyone? Welcome back to another episode of Beyond the Source Wall. And thank you all for those of you who watch my DC fandom videos that I did with my friend Gene. Gene's a really great guy, and we've been friends a long time. And like me, he's a brain aneurysm survivor too. And I just had a blast. Like, me and him both love DC stuff. That's kind of what made us friends originally. And as did this guy, the guy who wrote this book, Jeff Johns. He put out a book when I was recovering from my aneurysm that was called Brightest Day. I think it was near the end of it, and or maybe it was in the middle of it. I can't remember. I think it was towards the middle of it, before the Aquaman stuff started to pick up, I think it was. And so I started getting back into comics around that time, and reading a book about second chances was really uplifting to me as someone who was literally being given one. And so the book was written by Jeff Johns, Pete Tomasi. I think the art was by Ivan Reyes, who's a phenomenal artist. And it was a great team on a great book, I thought. I thought Brightest Day was really awesome. And around that time, I started noticing a pattern with Jeff Johns, because I liked his, Green Lantern run, obviously, and Star and Stripe, or Stars and Stripe, and his JSA stuff, and, the stuff he did with Goyer and everything. And I liked his stuff overall. Like, and he was, in the early to mid 2000s starting to rise up at DC, and then kind of really became like a rock star around 2010, 2011, when, like I said, when I was recovering from my aneurysm. And I went to Comic-Con 2011, a year after my aneurysm rupture, to tell him how much, and the panel, because I think Pete Tomasi was there too, to tell them how much Brightest Day meant to me. And, because of that, I got to meet Jeff and took a picture with him and everything. And he was a nice guy. Now, I know there's a lot of things going on currently with, accusations and things like that. I've worked in comics, I've worked in movies. I haven't heard some of the things, he's being accused of, but of course, I'm not Ray Fisher, and that's what Ray Fisher's saying. So if you want to know my thoughts on all that, I did make a video about it. If you want to go check that out, we did a live stream where I'm kind of, I try to be very fair and impartial, even though I have a bias. I like Jeff, but I also liked Ray as Cyborg. So it was, I kind of was of two minds of it. So if you want to check out that video, you can go check out that, because this here isn't for, that kind of stuff. This here is to talk about the work of Jeff Johns in this new book. And like I said, because I got to tell him that at Comic-Con 2011, Bleeding Cool wrote an article about me, and then I think they asked me to do an article too for them from my perspective. And that's how I met Gene, my friend Gene Hoyle. So we covered all the New 52 stuff, which is, Jeff Johns, Jim Lee launched the Justice League, where Cyborg was a member of the Justice League. It was fun, and I love talking DC with Gene. So I appreciate you guys checking that stuff out. Now, at the 3-minute marker, we're here with three Jokers. This book has been talked about for a while. Speaking of New 52, towards the end of New 52, Jeff Johns was writing Justice League, obviously, all the way up until the end, the main Justice League book. And he had this storyline called Darkseid War. And at the end of that storyline, or kind of towards the middle of the story, there was a moment where Batman sat on the Mobius chair, which is one of my favorite things in the DC universe, because it's connected to one of my favorite characters, who's at the intro of this show that you watch, Beyond the Source Wall, which is Metron. And Metron's one of my favorite DC characters. I love, don't really love the New Gods, although I'm a big Jack Kirby fan, but I love Metron. I love that character, and I'm very fascinated by that character. And his chair has this access to essentially infinite knowledge. So at a point in the New 52 universe, Batman gets bestowed that chair. He's sitting on it, and it asks, or it tells him, like, we'll answer any questions you have. And he said, okay, well, I want to know who killed my parents, like, definitively. And the chair said, Joe Chill killed your parents. And he said, okay. And he goes, well, then I want to know who the Joker is. And the chair said, which Joker? There's three of them. And so ever since then, we've all been like, what? what does that mean? Is that a multiverse thing? Is that like a clone thing? What is it? What could that possibly be? So we've been waiting, like, I think 3 or 4 years for this book to come out. I think they announced it like a year after Darkseid War. And so maybe we've been waiting 2 or 3 years for it. But Jason Fabok is the artist on it. And at the last minute, or I don't know about the last minute, maybe they did this a while ago, but they decided to make it a Black Label book, which now technically takes it out of continuity. And once that happened, my excitement for the book went way down. Obviously, New 52 stuff isn't fully in continuity anymore. Like, they didn't fully retcon it, but they kind of folded it into the old DC continuity. And, you know, especially with Superman, it was a little convoluted where he was like part of another Superman and part of the New 52 Superman or whatever. And so that was a whole thing. Comics, right? So it's a little hard to keep track of the continuity. So I think maybe what they decided to do was, we'll put this book out, we'll make it a drifting side continuity, to where if you've read all the New 52 stuff and you're kind of still locked into that universe and you like those stories, then this will kind of feel like an extension of that, you know, kind of almost a continuation, and not really be something that has real ramifications in the main DC universe. And once I heard that, I became less interested. And then once I started reading this book, I started getting bored. So a lot of you guys are probably going to be mad at me. Like I said, I like Jeff. I praise his work a lot. I love Doomsday Clock. I love a lot of his stuff. There's been a couple things here and there that I haven't liked that he's done. I've been critical of some of his TV and movie stuff. I've been critical of too. But this, the pattern, I said at the beginning of this episode, I noticed a pattern with Jeff Johns. Actually, I didn't notice it. I think I heard someone say it, and it kind of made me relook at his work. And now, you know, 8 years later, 9 years later, I still see that in his work. He definitely is an Alan Moore fan. And that's great. I'm an Alan Moore fan too. But you see that, like, you know, he watched, like, with Doomsday Clock. Okay, we got to do a sequel to Watchmen. Jeff's like, all right, I'll do that. Blackest Night, you know, that was a brief little tiny thing mentioned in the annual written by Alan Moore, the Green Lantern annual from back around the Crisis time, original Crisis. And it mentioned Blackest Night with Abensur and stuff. And so that is like something Jeff expanded on. Bringing Swamp Thing back to the DC universe, you know, because Alan Moore did a great run on Swamp Things, as did Len Wein. And that was kind of like a drifting, it was kind of in the DC universe for a while, and then it kind of drifted into Vertigo and stuff. And then now this, which is like, feels like him trying to do an Alan Moore-esque sequel to Killing Joke. And I guess I just didn't expect the story to be like that. This is going to be a long conversation, obviously. I know I'm building up to the actual issue here. We're going to talk about it. I have a lot to say going into this. Like, my expectations weren't, I feel like, set properly. And that's fine. I mean, that happens sometimes too. But then when I don't get a lot of information about the book and things like that, I start filling in the gaps myself, like most of us do. And I think my brain just went down a different way where I just thought, oh, this is going to be a cool Batman, Barbara Gordon, and Jason Todd story, and it'll deal with the Joker. But that's kind of all I had in my head. So when I started reading this and I saw that it was kind of paced with the Alan Moore, you know, like Watchmen / Killing Joke 9-panel grid thing, and it just started doing that, you know, kind of consistently and building up and everything and dragging things out. We talk about that. I talk about that in Donny Cates, how it's like, oh, you know, he spent like 10 pages recapping all the issues leading up to this event. And I felt that was unnecessary. I get really frustrated when writers do that. You know, so Jeff kind of does that here. He does this thing where Bruce Wayne crashes into the Wayne, his mother and father's tombstones outside the Wayne Manor, which I don't remember them being tombstones. I know they were in the animated series. And in the comics, I thought there was like a little mausoleum or something. I can't remember. Maybe I'm thinking of something else. But anyway, he crashes. It's a small detail. But he crashes through that. He's wounded. He comes out and he goes to Alfred. And Alfred's like, hey, what happened here? And then it shows a quick flash of Penguin stabbing Batman with the umbrella. And then Alfred starts stitching it up. And then you see his back and all the scars, and it shows Bane breaking it. And then you see, you know, like a burn mark here, and it's from the Riddler. So this goes on for like, you know, 2-3 pages, actually like 4 or 5 pages, I think. It goes on way too much. And what I realized when I was looking at this, I was like, okay, there's no dialogue, and they're just showing, you know, like, you know, Killer Croc bit Batman and Scarecrow stabbed Batman. And then a Joker did this. And then Joker did this. And then Joker did this. And then Joker did this. Obviously building up to how many times he's interacted with the Joker and how many different methods Joker has used. So to hurt Batman. So I get the point of it, but it's just one of those things that I just find very boring. And it was also something that had been done before, a little bit better, I feel, which is in Batman Hush. This is volume 2 of Batman Hush, the hardcover. In Batman Hush, there was a point in the comic books where I think they, I don't know if they took a month off or it was just like they needed an extra week or two to get the issue out or something. I can't remember. So, but they had planned it. It was like kind of planned. But an issue of Wizard Magazine was coming out in that week. So they added these four pages. And like I said, I'm sure it was planned from the get-go. They added these four pages into that Wizard Magazine, which then got, you know, recollected for the first time in these trade paperbacks. And those four pages are Alfred stitching up Batman and Catwoman saying, "Where'd you get that scar?" And he says, "Joker." And then she goes, "Where'd you get that scar?" And Two-Face shot him. And then she goes, "Well, I know where you got that scar. You got a scar on your chest because I scratched you." And he said, "Yep, that is exactly what happened." Sorry, my book almost fell there. So, "Yep, that's exactly what happened. You scratched me across the chest." It's four little pages, and there's other things going on besides that thing there, like besides just that. That only takes up two of the four pages. So that's Jeff Loeb and Jim Lee going, "All right, let's get to the meat of this and let's set up the next issue and let's give some action there in flashbacks for fans, you know, so they see some action." And, you know, you get to see, you know, Jim Lee draw Two-Face and Joker in those watercolor style and that Catwoman in watercolor style. So I kind of like that he did that. You know, they did it real brief, and that was in a Wizard magazine. It was supplemental free material if you bought Wizard magazine. And then when you got the trade of Hush, it was included in there. So to do that here in the beginning and stretch it out, I just found that kind of boring. And then when they go right from that into the origin of Batman, then I was really bored because I get why, again, Jeff's doing this. If you remember when Batman sat on the Mobius chair, he asked two questions: who is the Joker and who killed my parents? Joe Chill killed his parents. So, okay, so of course, you know, Jeff's going to reference that as well, but it's just having it all be like the first 10 pages was just a little too much for me. I didn't really dig it. Then they mentioned Lou Moxon, which is crazy. That's a name I've not heard in a long time. Lou Moxon, there was a time in the 50s of, I think, Batman comics where Lou Moxon was revealed to have maybe been the guy who hired Joe Chill to kill the Wayne family, and that was part of the continuity for a while. I had actually pitched a DC story, a Batman story, years ago when they did a comic called Batman Confidential, and I had written a couple people that I had met, you know, editor-wise at Comic-Con stuff, who were handling some of those books. Not exactly Batman Confidential. I think I was emailing a different editor, but I was trying to get to the Batman Confidential people, and I had pitched a story, which this was years ago. This was right before a movie came out called The Smoking Aces. And my story was basically Smoking Aces. It was Batman has to protect Lou Moxon for like, because he is turning state's evidence on all these other crime bosses in Gotham. And so he's, you know, he's working with the GCPD, but they need the FBI and people to come in to take him into custody. So they have like, they have to watch him overnight, and the FBI and stuff will get there at like, you know, 6 a.m. or something like that. So Batman is working with GCPD to protect Lou Moxon. And then as the night progresses, Lou, you know, Batman finds out Lou Moxon is the actual person who might've killed his, you know, had his parents killed, and therefore puts him in a conundrum of, well, do I save this guy or not? Because the other mob bosses that are being ratted out decide to hire assassins to go kill Lou Moxon. So like these eight assassins, it was eight, I think it was like seven or eight assassins. I had like Roxy Rocket I put in there because I loved her from the cartoon, Deadshot and a couple other people. And what was funny was that then Smoking Aces came out, and I was like, wow, this is pretty much very similar to my story for Batman. And then Batman Arkham Origins came out, and I was like, wow, that's pretty similar to my story for, except without the Lou Moxon part. So I know Lou Moxon as a character because I wrote a script with him in it, you know, as a target that bad guys were coming after, and Batman had to protect him until he realized who he was, and he's like, should I protect him? So anyway, that was the Batman Confidential story I, you know, drummed up years ago and tried to pitch. So when I heard Lou Moxon's name, I was like, hey, this is great. The Moxon family is this crime enterprise in Gotham that just hasn't gotten mentioned in a long time. So I kind of like that. But they're doing it while Barbara Gordon is working out at a gym. She's running again. She's on her feet. And she's having flashbacks of when Joker wore the Hawaiian shirt and shot her. For some reason, she still has holes in her. I feel like, I mean, I've never been shot, you know, so I don't know for sure, but I feel like those would close. Like this one looks a little closed, but it looks like there's a little depth in there, and that has way too much shadow on it. It looks like a full-on hole in her spine. And I'm sure that's not what they meant art-wise. And again, that's a nitpick. This doesn't hurt the story for me, but it's just one of those things where like, you know, it's a nitpick. But I was just like, wow, she still has two holes in her back, like not just scars where the, you know, or hole shaped scars. But yeah, I don't know. So I guess the skin didn't fully fill in, but it would. So then that's when I realized, oh, well, then this is a drifting continuity. Why is Barbara not Oracle in it? And I go, well, I guess if this is like a drifting New 52 continuity, she technically is back on her feet. So I guess that makes sense. So then it just goes through all the characters, you know, Barbara, Jason, and everything. I'm not going to go through this whole book beat for beat, you know, but I just wanted to say the intro, I wanted to kind of explain how bored I was when I was reading that intro. But as the book progressed, it gets a little better. You know, you have Gordon and Bullock working with Batman. They found that there's been three crimes committed in Gotham, all of which the Joker did. In one, he left an eyewitness to say that it was him that did the crime. In another, he live streamed it. And so it was like him on camera live streaming himself killing somebody. And then the last one was, you know, him leaving three dead bodies that were Jokerized so that you would, you know, and oh, the security cameras spotted him. He left the security cameras on and looked right into them so that, you know, they would know. So basically showing, hey, there are potentially three people dressed as Joker right now causing crimes. And so Batman's kind of like, oh, we got to look into this. We got to figure. So that's where the, now it doesn't feel like it's a continuation from New 52, because now Batman doesn't seem to know there are three Jokers, which the chair told him, and Mobius chair told him there were three Jokers. Now he's discovering there's three Jokers, or at least it seems written that way. So that confused me even more. So when I got to this part in the story, I was like, well, now I'm really confused of when and where this takes place. Because if this is a whole new continuity or a straight up sequel to Killing Joke, then I don't know why Red Hood, why even put Red Hood in the story, and why have Barbara Gordon not be Oracle? I started thinking in that way, you know? I'm glad these characters are in it. I don't know. It just made me go like, well, what's the thought process for this thing? Like, it feels like something where Jeff wrote it out and then DC said, no, you can't do that. It, you know, can't do it that way. And he had to maybe change some things as Jason was drawing it. And I think that's probably where my disconnect is coming from. I'm assuming. I don't know. But there is something about the story that is just not resonating with me. I see people online saying it was the best book last week and that they loved it. It was top notch and everything. The art is great. And I certainly don't hate the book. But I'm just like, there's a lot of things in it that I'm just like, I don't like. It's not that I don't understand the story. I completely understand the story. It's very transparent. But the structure and style of it, like these little beats here, they're very Alan Moore-ish and stuff. And I guess I kind of hoped Jeff would do things his own way. I like Jeff's writing style. And I understand why with Doomsday Clock, he had to mirror the Alan Moore, you know, kind of setup, because it was kind of a sequel to Watchmen in a way, but tying it into the DC universe. So in the end of the day, it still felt like a DC story with repercussions for DC characters, with a love letter to Superman. So that's why I like Doomsday Clock. This, I'm like, well, why are you structuring this like an Alan Moore? So you don't need to. You could make a Geoff Johns Batman story, actually, if you want. So I don't know. I feel like this one is, it doesn't feel completely like a Geoff Johns story. It feels like Geoff Johns imitating somebody while still trying to be himself, and it's not working for me. I mean, I'm sure a lot of you guys disagree with me, and that's totally fine. Let me know in the comments down below. But just to wrap it up, so there are three Jokers in this. There's one in a purple suit. There's one in a Hawaiian shirt, like the one who shot Barbara Gordon. He claims that he's the one who shot Barbara Gordon. The one in the purple suit claims that he's the one who killed Jason Todd. That does come into effect soon here in a minute. And then you have the third Joker who acts as the boss of the other two. And one of them doesn't like that he's the boss, kind of. But the other one's like, well, one of us has to be the boss. And they basically reveal that their plan here is that they want to make a better Joker. And that there's going to be auditions. So it seems to me that they stole this chemical. Like, the whole point of the story is that this chemical was stolen. It was the same chemical from Acme that created the Joker to begin with. I don't know why that stuff is still around after all these years. Like, why that wasn't disposed of properly or anything. Why Acme still makes that chemical. None of that makes any sense. Why it's all still conveniently there for Joker to just keep taking it when he needs it. It's so silly to me. This one Joker does flip a coin, Two-Face style, and asks, heads or tails, and the other two Jokers say heads at the same time, and then it lands on heads. So I was like, oh, that's a neat Two-Face reference, maybe. But he looks at the Jokers, and he sees the one in the Hawaiian shirt, and he sees the purple one. He says, all right, you come with me. You don't see who he's pointing to at first, but he says, you come with me. I think all that's intentional. Like, I feel like there's more going on here, so I'm definitely reading a lot into this book than I probably should, a lot more. But, you know, Jason and Batman and Robin, or Jason and Batman and Batgirl all team up, and they find out where Joker's going to be, and they go to this place where there's a giant, all that chemical stuff that was stolen is put into a giant fish tank, so all the fish and sharks have now been Jokerized. And then Gaggy shows up, this little, like, imp guy that was from the Carnival Freak Show that worked with Joker during the Killing Joke. And so that's what I'm saying. So Lou Moxon, they're referencing that. They're referencing Gaggy. All the villains, you know, have name tags that say Bow, Piff, Bam, all that kind of stuff, you know, referencing the old Adam West show. But they're definitely purposely, and Jeff's purposely referencing certain time periods of when Joker worked with, you know, guys like Gaggy, or, like, you know, knew of Lou Moxon and was part of that whole story. And he's definitely referencing these things on purpose, so you know, you can kind of get an insight if you're a longtime Batman fan of which Jokers are the three Jokers. Like, he's definitely hinting heavily at them, so you don't have to just take their word for it when they say, oh, I'm the one who killed Barbara, or I'm the one who killed Jason, and the other one says, I'm the one who, you know, hurt Barbara. You know, because this is my Hawaiian shirt or whatever. Like, he's like, don't take credit for what I did or whatever. So it seems like there's something going on with these three Jokers where I thought maybe that they're from three different timelines. That was kind of my mindset at first, was that, you know, how Jason Todd was brought back because Superboy Prime punched, you know, the crystal of reality or whatever, and it separated reality, and it found a way to reactivate or something, you know, or reactivate his brain, Jason Todd's brain or something, after the Lazarus Pit. I can't remember. Or it got him to dig himself out of the grave, I think, and then he was brain dead and went into the Lazarus Pit or something. Or he didn't go into it. I can't remember. Whatever. It's such a convoluted story, too. I was thinking that. I was like, maybe it's from that punch. There was three, like, the reality split, and for some reason that we'll find out, that three Jokers just happened to appear, all from different universes. I always joked about that. Actually, I pitched a story also before, after the idea I had for the Lou Moxon crime story. I had an idea for a Batman Confidential story where Joker actually does die. And I think I had Jason Todd kill him. Now this one, I don't know. I don't remember if I pitched it, to be fair. I know I pitched the Lou Moxon one. This one I know I had ready to pitch, but I don't remember who I showed it to, or if I showed it to someone at DC. But in it, I had Jason Todd kill a Joker, and then a Joker from another reality who was way worse than this Joker that killed Jason came into the DC universe, and then so Joker was still around, but the Joker everyone knew is dead. And this one that came from another world where he actually killed Batman and Robin is now in the DC universe. And he wants to kill this Batman and Robin. And that was like a story I had pitched. It was like a two-part story that I had worked up, where the end of issue one was Jason kills a Joker, and then issue two was at the end of it, a Joker from another reality came in. And I think I tied it even into the Crisis a little bit. I can't remember, Infinite Crisis, because I wrote it around that time after Infinite Crisis, and I just was like, yeah, I don't like the Joker, so let's kill him, and let's find a way to bring in a way worse Joker. Like, that was just my mindset. And then I talked to Judd Winnick, and Judd Winnick, I asked him, I said, do you think Jason would want to kill Joker? And I asked Judd Winnick, because Judd Winnick's the guy who kind of wrote Under the Red Hood and brought Jason back. So I wanted his input, and he said, no, Jason doesn't want to kill the Joker. Jason wants Bruce to kill the Joker. And once he said that, I remember going, well, now I don't like my story anymore. Like, my story that I wrote where Jason Todd kills Joker, and then a Joker from another reality comes in, I go, I don't like that story anymore, because I like what Judd Winnick said. I like that Jason's in a never, all superheroes and antiheroes have to be in a never-ending battle. They ultimately can't fully achieve what they're after. They can graze it, be a part of it, you know, accept it for a couple days, but it can't be a permanent thing. And so me going, Jason kills Joker, that's a permanent thing, even though we're bringing a different Joker from a different universe. But I like the idea of Jason wanting Bruce to do it, because Bruce will never do it. And so that gives Jason a never-ending battle. So to my surprise, I get to the end of this book, and Batman, Batgirl, and Jason all take down the Joker in the purple suit, which we don't know if that's actually him, or if he traded clothes with the Hawaiian shirt one, We don't know. But this one claims to be the one that killed Jason. So maybe it is him. He even says something that maybe only that Joker would know to kind of prove it, where he said, when I beat you with your brain in with a crowbar, do you remember your last words to me? You said, please don't hurt me. Please stop. I'll be your Robin. And Joker was like, ha ha. And look at that. Now you are my Robin. He's like, you're Red Hood. That was my identity for a while. And now you're me. And Jason hates hearing it. So he pulls out a gun. Barbara tells him to stop. Please don't shoot him. And then Jason pulls the trigger and kills this Joker, blows his brains out, and Barbara throws a batarang to try to stop it, but she misses. It like bounces off the gun, but not in a way to where it would knock the gun out of Jason's hand. It just kind of tinged off the top. And that's what Jason throws it in her face. She said, why'd you do that? And he goes, when have you ever missed? Implying that she intentionally didn't try to knock the gun out of his hand because on some level she wanted Joker dead too. I don't like this. I don't like this. Again, it's Jason. I know it, but I mean, I can accept it a little bit more because it's now an alternate reality. It's a black label book, so it's not continuity. So I can kind of accept it on that level. But still, seeing Jason kill Joker after all these years, after writing that story, like, you know, 14 years ago or whatever, 15 years ago, I seeing it on the page, even with beautiful art by Jason Fabok, I don't like it. I don't like the image of Jason standing over a dead Joker with a bullet from Jason's gun in his head. And now granted, this is just one Joker down and we got two more to go. And Barbara, of course, went after Jason, implied, hey, I think you let me kill him. She's like, screw you, Jason. And she walks away. As far as we know right now, that's not the Joker that hurt Barbara Gordon. So her chance for revenge may still be out there, but if she really wants it, I hope she doesn't. I don't think that's very heroic of these characters. And although Jason is an anti-hero, you always like to believe that on some level his soul can be saved. And I'm not like a goody two-shoes. I understand, and there are things in the world where it's like that seems like the most seems like a solution, you know, we're just taking somebody out, especially someone as vicious as Joker, who's caused not only Jason and Barbara pain, but killed so many people in Gotham. And that's kind of the reason why Jason pulls the trigger, I think. It's not fully selfish, although I'm sure it's partly selfish. But Jeff did put in the line where, you know, Jason says, look, the cycle's never going to end. This guy keeps breaking out. He keeps getting loose, keeps hurting people. He just killed people recently. He just, you know, infected all this water with this Joker chemical. Like, he's not going to stop unless we stop him. So I'm pulling the trigger. So I get the reasoning. I get the rationale. It doesn't break my heart or anything. I'm not that upset by it, but still seeing it, I'm just kind of like, yeah. But again, it's a drifting continuity. So like I said, I can kind of accept it a little bit more. So I don't hate this book. I don't. The art's phenomenal. And there are parts of it that are really well written, but pacing wise, I don't like the pacing at all, especially the first issue. Like, maybe the second issue will change my mind, but I did not like the pacing of this issue at all. I thought it was, I like slow stories, but this was just not an interesting slow to me. But I understand I'm in the minority because it seems like people love this book. So if you're one of those people and you have points in it that you'd like to make that you loved about the book that I didn't bring up or that I thought was negative and you want to counter it, please, like, I'm open to, you know, any conversation down in the comments below. I love hearing other people's opinions. I want to know what you liked about it. If you didn't like this book, tell me what you didn't like about it. Maybe you didn't like different things than I did, you know, whatever. Whatever it is, I love conversation. So let me know in the comments below and we'll continue our conversation down there. But yeah, that's my thoughts on this. Like, if I had to rate this book, if I had to like give it a out of 5 stars, I'd probably give it like a 3. Like, you know, it's not awful. Like I said, I guess, like I said, maybe it's my own fault for my setting of expectations. But seeing like something that feels like a sequel to Killing Joke, pacing wise and stuff, it just doesn't work for me because Jason wasn't in Killing Joke. He was in Death in the Family, you know, or Death of the Family, the original story where he gets killed and you had to call in and vote to if you wanted him to live or not. I wanted him to live. Everyone else, you know, disagreed with me. Although we didn't lose by that many votes, but now there's an animated movie coming out where I can vote for him to live and he'll live, which I'm excited for. I'm excited for that movie. And we'll definitely review it when it comes out. But for this, I don't know. I'm mixed and Because of that, that's why I give it a 3. I think the artwork's phenomenal. I think Jason Fabok is great. Although I felt like, I mean, I'm sure some people would call them nods. I feel like they maybe could be swipes on some level. But there's a scene where, right here, where Jason's remembering dying at the hands of the Joker. And that panel looks almost just like Jim Lee's panel, positioning and lips and everything. Although Jason Fabok kind of has that style. I think he's a big Jim Lee fan, and, you know, kind of inspired by Jim Lee. But that looks like it was straight out of Hush. And like I said, this felt like straight out of Hush too. So that's why I was kind of like, and I understand they would reference Hush to an extent, maybe, and maybe they did that obviously intentionally, because that's where we technically got Jason Todd back for the first time. There was a point in Hush where Jason Todd shows up, and, you know, I don't want to spoil too much of Hush, but we find out it's not really Jason Todd. But then later on, Judd Winnick, in an annual, Batman Annual 26, I think, he retcons that and makes it to where it actually was Jason in the beginning, and then it became someone else who filled in for him afterwards. And, you know, like I said, convoluted stuff sometimes in comics, but I liked that. I thought that was cool, because then it made that moment where Jason is revealed in Hush feel like a real moment. You know, I was like, okay, good. It is a real moment. It's not just some, like, parlor trick. It was a real moment, thanks to Judd Winnick later on. So, and I think originally, I think Hush was supposed to be Jason Todd, and the internet kind of ruined that, so they decided to change it last second. Which makes sense, because Tommy Elliot is not a very fleshed out character. So he became one eventually, but at that time he wasn't. I like him with the Bruce Wayne face. Actually, that's my favorite version of Hush, is he takes the bandages off and he did plastic surgery on himself and made himself look like Bruce Wayne. Like, how, that's demented. Like, I love that. That's so awesome. Anyway, so, you know, let me know what you think of Batman 3 Jokers. You know, I'm just mixed on it. I don't hate this book. For sure don't hate this book. But I just don't love it as much as everybody else loved it. For me, it's a 3 out of 5. And that's because the artwork is really good. And there were good beats, some good beats in it. But overall, the tone and the pacing of it, I just didn't feel like this was really Jeff, you know, being Jeff. Like, his Shazam run feels like Jeff. Doomsday Clock feels like Jeff. But Doomsday Clock feels like Jeff paying homage, in a way, to Alan Moore's writing style only when he's writing the Watchmen characters. But then when he writes the DC characters, they feel very DC and very Geoff Johns-like. And I like that. This didn't really feel like a lot of Geoff Johns in it. It felt, like I said, like a lot of imitation. And maybe that's intentional, you know, for the tone-wise, but it just didn't gel with me. But if it did with you, let me know down below. We'll continue our conversation down there. Thanks so much for watching the show. As always, like, share, subscribe, all that fun stuff. And I'll see you all in the future. Peace.